Shall we start, sir?
Yeah, I think. Yeah, Narayan Swami, you can start.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
There are already sufficient 30 people have joined.
Good evening to all. Today's virtual monthly clinical meeting being hosted by Medicine Department BLD, Deemed University, Sri B.M. Patil Medical College Hospitals, Vijayapur. For today's function, on behalf of APA Karnataka chapter, I welcome our chairman, Dr. V.A. Kotiwale, Professor of Medicine, Registrar, KLE Academy of Higher Education, and I request Dr. Kotiwale, sir, to conduct today's monthly clinical meeting.
Yeah.
On behalf of APA Karnataka chapter, I welcome Dr. Sharan Badigher, HOD of Medicine, BLD, Deemed University. And I also welcome, on behalf of APA Karnataka chapter, Dr. Rajesh Vannutugi, Professor of Medicine. I welcome Dr. Anand Ambali, Professor of Geriatrics. And I welcome all the faculty members of BLD, Deemed University. And I welcome, on behalf of APA Karnataka chapter, today's presenters, Dr. Siddharth Chawat, Dr. Chetan Raj, Dr. Santosh BT, and Dr. Ravi Teja. I welcome all the senior professors, and I welcome all the honorable API members for today's virtual monthly clinical meeting. Over to Dr. V.A. Kotiwale, sir.
Good evening, all the respected members of our Association Physician of India Karnataka chapter. I hope that all of us must have received our COVID vaccines, because drive is there since last 4 days, and all the frontline warriors, especially the physicians, intensivists, have received, and the names have been allotted, and majority of us have taken here, wishing the same from everyone. As you know, in due course of a time, we will have an offline meeting at Bangalore, but this is a great opportunity for us that this institute like Belagaon, Mysore, and Bijapur can have a meeting virtually. And this trend, we will continue further, and having to have 2-3 cases from 2 colleges, so that number of colleges are more, considering this online virtual meetings really made us to make use of all the departments across the Karnataka. Without wasting time, there are interesting cases. I really thankful that the BLD Institute Medicine Department have accepted this and to host this meeting. And now there are interesting cases. I call upon the Siddharth, who will present for 7-8 minutes, and maybe 10 minutes, and then we can have a discussion for 5 minutes. And now I request Siddharth Chawat, who is going to have a case on Alström syndrome, since it is something genetically, and it is this, and let us see how they have worked up this case and how they have come to the diagnosis. Let us see. Siddharth from BLD.
Sorry for interruption, sir. First of all, I take few minutes before starting the cases. First of all, I am very much thankful to API Karnataka State Chapter for giving us opportunity. This is a rare opportunity, because as we are all aware that it was usually conducted at Bangalore, and usually these cases were being presented by medical colleges which are situated in Bangalore. Thanks to COVID that this opportunity is given for other places also, and I am very much thankful to Chairman Sir and Secretary and other honorable members of API for giving us opportunity to present cases for today's meeting. Now I request our postgraduate student, Dr. Siddharth, to go ahead with his discussion. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, everyone. Myself, Dr. Siddharth Kumar Chawat, third year postgraduate, Institute B.M. Patel Medical College. Today, I'm going to present the case of Alstom syndrome. Clinical history: Mr. XYZ, 18-year-old male, hailing from Vijayapur, North Karnataka, studied till 6th standard, currently unemployed, presented with chief complaints of blood and vomiting since one day. Patient was in his normal state of health till he had 2 to 3 episodes of vomiting, sudden in onset, non-projectile. The vomiters contained food particle and fresh blood around a handful each time. Non-foul smelling associated with nausea. No history of pain abdomen, loose stools or constipation, or cough with expectoration, fever, weight loss or loss of appetite. He had no history of chest pain or palpitation, sweating or syncope. Past history: patient is blind since birth. Patient is diabetic since 14 years of age and was on both regular insulin and oral hypoglycemic agent like tablet metformin 500 mg 1 BD. Patient is not a known case of pulmonary cough, bronchial asthma, congenital heart disease or seizure disorder. Family history: patient is the only child to his parents, no similar history in the family. Birth history: patient is born to non-consanguineously married couple with birth weight of 2.9 kg after full term elective cesarean section with no perinatal complication. Developmental history: gross motor milestone, fine motor milestone, language milestone and social milestone were achieved at appropriate age. Personal history: appetite was reduced, patient consumes mixed diet, bladder frequency is 3 to 4 times per day, bowel 1 to 2 times per day and sleep is undisturbed. Coming to clinical examination: on general physical examination, patient is conscious and well oriented to time, place and person. His height was 150 cm. At his age of 18 years, the third percentile is around 158 cm, hence considered to be short stature. Weight is around 45.2 kgs and body mass index is 20.77 kg per meter square. His vitals, pulse rate were 120 beats per minute, blood pressure 100 by 70 millimeters of mercury, respiratory rate 24 cycles per minute and temperature is 37.6 degrees Celsius. On further examining, conjunctiva is pale, he had round face, fontal balding and axilla showed thick velvety skin, surface rugose and mammillated, suggestive of acanthosis nigricans as shown in the figure 1. On ocular examination, there was bilateral horizontal nystagmus and divergent squint as shown in figure 3, and figure 4, which shows fundus examination, which showed features suggestive of atypical retinitis pigmentosa with optic atrophy in both the eyes. And genital examination showed bilateral atrophic testes. On further systemic examination, parabdominal examination showed soft, non-tender, with spleen was palpable, and clinical examination of other systems were within normal limits. So after history and physical examination, I've come to a conclusion of hematemesis with secondary to portal hypertension, with anemia and with diabetes mellitus and bilateral retinitis pigmentosa. And in the setting of atypical retinitis pigmentosa and diabetic mellitus, I would like to consider a syndromic approach, and the four common syndromes associated with atypical retinitis pigmentosa and diabetic mellitus are Bardet-Biedl syndrome, Alstom syndrome, Kearse-Sayre syndrome and Wolfram syndrome. Further investigating, blood parameters showed total count were raised, which is around 23,680 with neutrophilic predominance, and hemoglobin was 4.3 gram per cent. Whereas peripherals may have showed normocytic normochromic anemia with neutrophilic leukocytosis. Random blood sugar was 534 mg per deciliter presentation, and glycosidic hemoglobin were 11.4%, whereas prothrombin time and INR was within normal limit. Urine examination showed sugars were present, whereas ketone bodies were absent. Further, renal function test and liver function test. In liver function test, SGOT, SGPT, alkaline phosphatase were raised, whereas other parameters were within normal limit. And for evaluation of the liver pathology, hepatitis B virus, HCV virus, and HIV were negative. Further, on radiological investigation, USG abdomen showed portal vein diameter of 15 mm, which was suggestive of portal hypertension. And scrotal ultrasonogram showed right testis of 13 to 9 mm, that is on 0.5 cc, and left testis was 10 into 12 mm, which is on 0.9 cc. So both these parameters were reduced according to age and were suggestive of bilateral testicular atrophy. Upper gastrointestinal endoscopy showed grade 2 and 3 esophageal varices with mid and lower esophagus. On further histopathological investigation, we did liver biopsy, which showed features suggestive of fatty liver. So after investigating thoroughly the patient, we came to a conclusion where positive findings in our patient were the patient had insulin resistant diabetic mellitus, the patient had atypical retinitis pigmentosa, the patient had hypogonadism, and he had even hepatic involvement, which where fatty liver was present and portal hypertension was present, and the patient was short stature for his age, and acanthesis nigricans were present. So all these parameters on deducing, we came to a further reduction of Alström syndrome, where almost all the features were fitting into it. So for further confirming the diagnosis, we went ahead with the Marsh's diagnostic criteria, which is specifically used to diagnose Alström syndrome, wherein it can be two major criteria or two minor criteria can be present. But on broad classification, the diagnostic criteria is divided based on the age. The diagnostic criteria present for birth to 2 years, 3 to 14 years, and 15 years to adulthood. The third column shows 15 years to adulthood, where our patient is around 18 years of age. So in this case, what we had was, first thing, history of nystagmus was present, child was having blindness with cone rod dystrophy, so one major criteria was satisfied. And coming to minor criteria, the patient had insulin resistant type 2 diabetes mellitus, hepatic dysfunction, short stature, and hypogonadism. So one major and four minor criteria were fitting into it. And whereas we had other variable support where he had normal digits, no polydactyly. So this polydactyly rules out bilateral syndrome, which is more common. So we came out to the conclusion of Alström syndrome as our diagnosis. Our final diagnosis was Alström syndrome after deducting all the four syndromes. Further, knowing about Alström syndrome, it's a rare autosomal recessive single gene disorder involving multiple systems. It was first described by Carl Henry Alström in 1959, and it is prevalence of less than 1 in 1 million children. Approximately 700 cases have been reported worldwide, out of which only 20 cases have been reported from India. While previous case of Alström syndrome with unilateral absent testis have been reported, this case is an add-on to the literature with combination of Alström syndrome with bilateral testicular atrophy. And this case was even presented in an international journal where we have presented as Alström syndrome with bilateral testicular atrophy. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Siddharth.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, now the simple X-ray and echo, why you are not done?
The echo is almost done, sir. Echo showed normal LV systolic function with LV ejection fraction of 60% was present, sir.
Normal. Yeah, actually, Alström syndrome is associated with cardiomyopathy.
Yeah, exactly, sir.
Then X-ray is also would have been helpful to you and to make something different thing.
Both X-ray and 2D echo were done, sir. I have not added just to save the time, sir, because we had a limit of 5 minutes. I want to just
not 5 minutes. You would have taken. Okay, no problem. But X-ray and echo both are normal.
Yes, sir. Absolutely normal, sir.
Yeah, yeah. The Alström syndrome is associated with usually cardiomyopathy and retinal blindness and diabetes. Three things are very important. However, yes, the criteria what you have put, have you made any attempt to have a genetic testing for this?
Genetic testings we are about to do, sir. The patient is still in contact with us. Though we have settled all the criteria for Alström syndrome with Marshall's criteria, we are still going ahead with genetic testing now, sir, for doing AL1 mutations.
Yeah, since the cardiomyopathy is not there, you need to have a genetic testing and you may find something different and important for information.
True, sir. We are keeping the patient in contact, and every 6 months we have asked him to come for regular checkup, sir, and we are doing echo every yearly, sir, because we know he has high potency chances to get the cardiomyopathy in future.
any participants wants to have, they can, if possible, they can have one or two questions, or they can put the questions on chat box. At the end also, we can take the discussion. Yeah, since there are no other things, now to save time, I would thank you very much, Siddharth. And it is interesting and good case. And we'll go ahead with the next case. Again, interesting from Dr. Chetan. Let us see, what is it, IgG4 syndrome?
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay, sir. Second or third?
Ananti Ambali. Excuse me.
Yes, sir.
Hello, can I say? Well, at the outset, I would like to compliment the institution for presentation of a rare case. However, the point raised about genetic testing is a very valid one. And since you have presented it as a paper in the international conference also, so it will be worth doing that. My question to you was, is it a testicular atrophy or a underdevelopment?
It's a testicular atrophy, sir, because at the age of 18 years, where you consider the parameters, the volume is itself is 0.5 cc, sir, which is normally it should be around 1.2 cc. So it has come down to 0.5 cc. So we are considering the testicular atrophy itself, sir.
Would you also like to do the androgen levels?
Yes, sir. Androgen levels, testosterone level, consider it, sir. We are further testing it for it, sir. But in the USG parameter itself, scrotal USG, we have got reduced testicular volume. We are considered as atrophic testis.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Welcome, sir. Dr. O.P. Sharma, welcome, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
It is our privilege that you have joined, and it is it makes us a lot of greatness to our this meeting.
Great, sir. Thank you.
Chetan. Chetan?
Good evening, everyone. I am presenting a case presentation under the... I am Dr. Chetan Rajpurit. I am presenting a case presentation under the guidance of Dr. Vijay Kumar Jeevarath and Dr. Amisha Reddy. Here is a patient, 64 years male, hailing from Salasamba, came with complaints of generalized weakness since past 3 years, aggravated since 2 months, and complaints of pain abdomen since 1 month. History of presenting complaints, patient was apparently already 3 years back, started to notice generalized weakness, insidious onset, progressive in nature, associated with history of excessive fatigability and increased sleep, and above symptoms persisted for 15 days. Treated at local hospital for the same, and treated with 7 days with symptomatic treatment, and patient improved. Patient was apparently all right for period of 1 year. After 1 year, he developed a new symptom of cough, which was persistent throughout the day, mild to moderate degree, not associated with fever, no postural or diurnal variation, associated with breathlessness, MRC grade 2. He also associated with history of, again, generalized body ache and generalized weakness. Patient used to take treatment at local hospital for above symptoms with oral analgesics and intramuscular injections, and used to get relieved. Above symptoms persisted for duration of 2 months. After 2 months, he started to develop the swelling in front of a neck noticed by the family members, which is progressed in size over the duration of 15 days. Patient also developed swelling around the eyes during this period and was asymmetrical, used to involve each eye separately, lasting for 5 to 7 days, and used to subside on its own, not associated with any pain. During this period, he went to hospital in Solapur and was diagnosed to be having thyroid disease and was started with antithyroid medications. His symptoms didn't improve much, but had a slight decrease in neck swelling and was able to take orally. After 1 week of discharge, he started having a swelling around the eyes. New symptom developed that he started having a difficulty in opening mouth and difficulty in chewing and pain in the angle of the mouth on both sides and associated with the history of generalized weakness and body pain. Patient was readmitted in the same hospital and evaluated and started him on oral steroids. His symptoms improved and discharged within a week. After 15 days of discharge, patient started having similar symptoms. Patient started taking, again, he stopped in between and again started taking oral steroids every alternative day and was doing fine. And stopped steroids on his own since past 2 months. He came to our hospital with complaint of generalized weakness since 2 months. New symptom of pain abdomen since 1 month, dull aching in nature in upper abdomen, which is radiating to back, not relieved on rest or medication or by food. No complaints of fever, cough or headache, no complaints of constipation, loose stools, no history of blood transfusions. Past history, not a known case of type 2 diabetes mellitus, hypertension, ischemic heart disease or tuberculosis. Family history, married since 35 years, has 4 children, all keeping good health. Personal history, diet mixed, predominantly vegetarian, appetite reduced, sleep disturbed, bowel and bladder habits regular, addictive habits are nil. General physical examination, eyes, periorbital swelling was present, lower eyelid edema present in both eyes, pallor and clubbing, both were present, skin desquamation present over the both upper and lower extremity, well-defined annular plaque over the scaling over the buttock and groin present, whitish to yellowish nail plate with crumbling nail plate present over the left fingernails, oral cavity is oval to open malampathy class 3, bilateral parotid gland slight enlargement present, no edema or lymphadenopathy. Vitals pulse 126 beats per minute regular, blood pressure 126/82 millimeter of mercury, temperature, he was afebrile and respiratory rate was normal. Systemic examination was normal, rectal examination shows us posterior anal fissure. So we got investigations, it was showing HB of 8.6 and MCV 84.8, peripheral smear showing normocytic normochromic anemia with neutrophilic leukocytosis. Urine routine shows albuminuria 30 milligram per deciliter. His RFT showed creatinine of 2.1 mg per deciliter and potassium 5.3 milliequivalent per liter and corrected calcium was 7.46. Parathormone levels were increased 57.1, vitamin D total and was normal and thyroid profile was normal. TPO was negative, serum phosphorus amylase lipase was normal, viral markers were normal, negative, non-reactive and ultrasound neck showed normal. ECG was showing sinus tachycardia. Patient empirically started on IV antibiotics, intravenous fluids, antacid, antiemetics, injection IV iron sucrose, oral steroids tablet prednisolone 40 mg is continued and tablet pneumoprazole is stopped. Ultrasound abdomen showed bilateral renal enlargement. We got CT abdomen, it shows bilateral renal enlargement with hypotense lesion in the renal parenchyma. Renal biopsy shows histopathological examination which revealed the dense lymphoplasmocytic infiltrate and IHC suggestive of IgG4 relative disease with positivity for IgG4. Complement levels C3 and C4 levels were reduced. IgG4 levels were twice the normal, increased twice the normal. So when we got to know that inclusion, when we got that inclusion criteria for from the American College of Rheumatology, and we considered and we put our findings, radiological findings, histopathological findings, clinical features, serological tests, and we got the total score of 26. The minimum needed score for positivity for IgG4 was 20. So we made a diagnosis of immunoglobulin G4 related disease. We patient after that discharged with tablet prednisolone 40 mg OD, and patient is coming came after for 1 month for follow-up, and patient symptoms were reduced and prednisolone dose were tapered. Patient was planned for rituximab, but according to economical non-affordability, we have not planned. Discussion, immunoglobulin G4 related disease is a multi-organ immune mediated condition that mimics many malignant, infectious and inflammatory disorders. The disease first crept into medical literature in 2003. Features of epidemiology of IgG4 related disease will remain elusive until the disease is recognized more broadly. No randomized clinical trials have been performed to evaluate the comparative effectiveness of different treatment regimens, and optimal treatment of IgG4 related disease is still unknown. Current approaches to management are based on the observational case series. The decision to treat the patient is predicated upon the patient's symptoms and the organ system involved. Thank you.
Okay, interesting case. Now, how long you are following up this case, and what predisposed this to come to you all in this?
Sir, patient is coming for follow-up every one month, every monthly, sir. We want him to start rituximab, sir, because he might go for, we can't start him on long-term oral steroids. But because of his non-affordability, we are just continuing and tapering the dose, sir, with the oral steroids, sir.
Yeah, in the literature, how follow-up data and how they, what is their progression to other end things or what?
Sir, according to the data suggestive of the patient will go for renal atrophy if sooner or later, sir. But to prevent that, we are treating him on oral steroids. But we can't treat him on a lifelong with oral steroids. So we will stop in between and we'll again start because of his economic unaffordability, sir.
Now creatinine itself is now, the creatinine itself is 2.3 something.
Yes, sir.
And then do you have a last previous reports and comparatively whether it is same or what is the thing?
Creatinine level is reduced to 1.7, sir, now. But IgG4 levels we have not repeated, but we will repeat again. We will come for follow-up, sir, next follow-up.
Okay. Yeah. Any other questions you have? Any of the members? Yeah, if anybody wants to have a chat box, you put the questions on the chat box. At the end, we can take. Yeah, thank you, Chetan.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
I am Dr. Bhushi. Can you tell me that something about what is the complication?
Sir, complication.
Chetan, they want to know about the what can happen. What are the complications of this?
Sir, it is. Complication of first of all is disease complication.
Yes, sir.
Because it is a long-term disease, can it develop some complications?
Yes,
and the complication of prednisolone, if it is taken for the long time, it gives some complications.
We are monitoring his this one, sir. Every time we are monitoring it, we are asking him any fractures, any you are more prone for fracture, any fracture is there. Or you are having any symptoms, your symptoms are not reducing with the steroids. We are asking him every time he will come for the follow-up, sir. And we are trying to taper, we have planned to taper and reduce and again intermittently we start oral steroids, sir, not to continuously start him on the oral steroids.
Sir, one more question is there.
Yes,
is there is any differential diagnosis for this disease?
Sir, if we
differential
go...
Differential diagnosis for particular disease.
Sir, any autoimmune disease like Sjögren syndrome or SLE might come under this, sir. But if we go through the renal biopsy, but the plasma lymphocytic infiltration is right now IgG4, sir. And immunohistology is suggestive of more this thing of IgG4 cells. It was suggestive, sir, more than 40%. So we thought it as IgG4, sir. Or it can go for any autoimmune disease, sir, if it includes multiple systems.
I just wanted to ask two small questions. With your permission, Chairman, sir.
Yeah, please,
I just want to ask two small questions. One is that apart from the kidney involvement, is there any other evidence of vasculopathy? Number one. Number two, since you want to give intermittently oral steroids, why don't you consider giving the patient pulse therapy? What are your views on that?
Sir, first of all, you had bilateral parotid enlargement also, sir. And second thing, when we got his CT done, there is no, actually there will be retroperitoneal fibrosis also associated with, and autoimmune pancreatitis he might go for, sir. But these findings were not there. And about the treatment part, we will think, sir. About the pulse therapy, we will definitely think about that, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Chetan. Now we call upon the next speaker, Santosh, who will be talking on the scientist, Baruha Blumger. We'll listen from him. The eminent people have to be remembered in this event. Santosh.
A very good evening to everyone. Myself, Dr. Santosh. I'm a postgraduate student in General Medicine Department. So firstly, I would like to thank all the API Karnataka chapter dignitaries for giving this opportunity to talk in this esteemed platform. For the next few minutes, I will be going to talk about the few words regarding Baruch Samuel Blumberg, who is a Nobel laureate. A Baruch Samuel Blumberg is also known as Barry Blumberg. So he is an American physician and geneticist born on July 28, 1925 in New York City. He has an excellent contribution to the medical science which made mankind to live safe. He and his colleague discovered the virus in 1967, developed the blood test that is used to detect the virus and invented the first hepatitis B vaccine in 1969. So this is the great thing about him. A single person had made a complete study on the one single virus, who has invented it, made a test to detect it, and at the same time made a vaccine to cure it. So for his huge contribution, so in 1976, Dr. Blumberg honored with a Nobel Prize in the medicine for his discovery of hepatitis B virus. So there was another co-participant like for the Nobel Prize known by the Daniel Carlton. So how it gets started? So as we all know, all the scientific findings are often serendipitous. It's been discovered unexpectedly. So everything started from a question in his mind that why some people contract a disease in a given environment while others do not. So throughout the 1950s, he traveled all around the world collecting a human blood samples to study the genetic variations in different areas of the world. So particularly he started collecting the blood samples of hemophiliac and leukemic patients all around the world, just because they have received multiple transfusions from the different people, so they will be having a preformed multiple antibodies against the polymorphic serum proteins. So the collection of the blood kept on going. So in 1965, there was a big breakthrough that one blood sample of Australian Aborigines, means the origin of the Australian tribes, had reacted with an antibody in the serum of American hemophilia patients, and that was named as an Australian antigen. So hence, even the hepatitis B virus, before it was called as an hepatitis B virus, it was called as an Australian antigen. So a series of research and clinical observation led to the confirmation that Australian antigen caused hepatitis B, and thus this was how the hepatitis B was discovered. The 4 years later, Dr. Blumberg and the Dr. Irving Milman invented the hepatitis B vaccine. The hepatitis B vaccine is the first anti-cancer vaccine because it can help prevent the liver cancer, because we all know hepatitis itself is the cause for the major percentage of the cancer. So working with the Dr. Blumberg, the microbiologist Irving Milman helped to develop a blood test for the hepatitis B virus. So in January 1986, he flew to India and served as the professor of Indian Academy of Sciences at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, for about 3 months. So surprisingly, in January 20th of 86, he met the Prime Minister of India, Rajiv Gandhi, and gave the suggestions regarding all the things like starting the vaccine productions and the vaccine program in India, starting promotion to use the disposable needles and its productions. So we all know like how the olden days the needle used to be used, like it used to be boiled and reused. So he was the one who proposed to the government that start the production of the disposable needles. So hence it will prevent the contractable diseases. And he also suggested establishment of the graduate level schools of public health and upgrading of water supplies in the large cities. So what was the impact of all the research he has done? So as they invented the test to find out the hepatitis B, all the blood banks began using the test in 1971 to screen the blood donations, and hence the risk of hepatitis B infections from the blood transfusion has been decreased by almost 25%. So there were many sayings even said about the Blumberg, the one who worked with him. So one of the scientific director at the Fox Chase Cancer Center, Jonathan Chernoff, said, I think it's fair to say that Barry prevented more cancer deaths than any person who's ever lived. So of course we have to agree this, because if we have not invented the treatment like vaccine for the hepatitis B, the whole world would have been suffered a lot. And even in the reference to the Blumberg's discovery of the hepatitis B vaccine, the former NASA administrator Daniel Goldin said, "Our planet is an improved place as a result of Barry's few short days in residence." So even the many scientists who have worked with him, so out of them, even R.V. J. Alter, who have been recently awarded a Nobel Prize for the discovery of hepatitis C, has also worked with the Blomberg for the detection of Australian antigen. So to show the gratitude and remembrance of this great personality, the World Hepatitis Day is observed on his birthday of every July 28th of every year. So the Blumberg left us on the April 5th of 2011. So during his last days, the Blumberg was distinguished scientist at the NASA Lunar Science Institute, California. So thanking you all for giving me this opportunity to share my words, few words about the great personality, Dr. Baroj Blumberg.
Yeah, thank you, Santosh. You have chosen a person who has come to India and really made a lot of impact to the whole world on various vaccines and development of prevention of complications in various conditions.
Yeah, of course, sir. Even that was very surprisingly when I gone through his autobiography. So even I was surprised to know the fact that he has flew to the India, worked as a professor, and even given a suggestion to the Prime Minister of India to do such good things.
A few people have really contributed a lot. And then that is why the BD syringes, needles, which have come to us as a remarkable impact to the nation as well as world. We are a good manufacturing unit as far as the syringes are concerned. And earlier, we used to boil all the needles and give, and only boiling water only we used to dip for 5 minutes, 10 minutes and use them repeatedly. Okay. Yeah. With this, I think we'll not have any questions on this. And it is a tribute to all these scientists. And then it is a good information we got from him. Yes, now next one more presentation is a capillary leak syndrome from Ravi. Yeah. Ravi.
Sir, one second. Good evening to everyone. Today I am Dr. Ravi Teja, PG in General Medicine. Today I'm going to discuss about capillary leak syndrome in a viper bite patient. Here is a 32-year-old male patient, farmer by occupation, presented to our emergency department with history of snake bite on his right great toe while he was praying in his field. He was brought to our hospital after four hours of bite. He was complaining of bleeding gums, pain and swelling in the great toe. At casualty, he was hemodynamically stable, vitals, pulse rate was 92 beats per minute, BP 110 by 70 millimeters of mercury. 20-minute whole blood clotting test showed no clot formation. Hence, conclusion of vascotoxic snake bite was made. We admitted the patient in ICU and anti-snake venom infusion was started and a total of 34 vials of anti-snake venom was given over first 24 hours of admission. And basic investigations like complete blood picture, urine routine, renal function test, coagulation profile and ABG was sent, which were normal except coagulation profile at the time of admission. Within 12 hours of admission, we noticed bilateral parotid gland swelling and periorbital edema. His urine output was reduced and chest x-ray showed features of ARDS with drop in saturation, so we intubated the patient. Coming to investigations, his platelet count reduced from 2.2 lakh at the time of admission to 19,000 to day 4. And his packet cell volume, hematocrit, has increased from 44% to 58%. And serum creatinine has improved, has increased from 0.8 milligram per deciliter to 8 milligram per deciliter. And serum albumin has reduced from 4.6 to 1.8. On the day 3, patient was hemodynamically not stable and vitals are pulse 102 beats per minute, BP 80 millimeters of mercury systolic. So we started the patient on vasopressors and inotrope support. Patient had persistent hypotension and expired on day 4 of admission. We have given, this is the management we have given, total of 34 vials of ASV and antibiotics, meropenem and metronidazole, injection methylprednisolone, 40 mg IV TDS, and 2 cycles of hemodialysis was done, and inotrope support was given. In our patient, plasmapheresis could not be done because of hemodynamic instability. Discussion. Capillary leak syndrome is a rare complication of viper snake bite, which is associated with high mortality, approximately 60%. Coming to pathogenesis, there are three mechanisms by which this snake bite can cause increased capillary permeability. One is zinc metalloproteinase present in the viper venom will cause direct, will damage the capillary membrane. And one more is vascular apoptosis inducing proteins, which can cause apoptosis of the capillary endothelium. And one more is phospholipase A2. It will increase the inflammatory reaction and thereby increases the capillary permeability. This increased capillary permeability leads to leakage of plasma into interstitial space, edema formation, hypoalbuminemia, and intravascular volume depletion. Diagnosis is made in the presence of bilateral parotid swelling, chemosis, and periorbital edema following snake bite, and along with any of the three or more of the following, like systolic blood pressure less than 90, hematocrit more than 45%, and proteinuria defined by protein creatinine ratio more than 1, and serum albumin less than 3, and sonological evidence of third space fluid collection. Other treatment options are like, there are few case reports claiming successful management of capillary leak syndrome with plasmapheresis. The postulated mechanism of action of plasmapheresis is removal of the components of venom responsible for capillary damage that are not effectively neutralized by antivenom. Plasmapheresis can also, to some extent, remove the cytokines and other inflammatory mediators implicated in the pathogenesis of capillary damage. Take-home message, all the patients of viper bite should be looked for parotid enlargement and periorbital edema to suspect capillary leak syndrome. Early diagnosis of capillary leak syndrome and treatment with plasmapheresis may improve the outcome of the patient and thereby decrease the mortality of these patients. These are the references. This is one of the study done at Kerala Thiruvananthapuram. It is claiming that if the patient has given plasmapheresis, patient patient was improved. And this is one more reference, parotid swelling after Russell's viper innovation, an unusual and poor prognostic sign. Thank you.
Now, actually, if you are given, what is the duration with the bite he has admitted to the hospital?
What, sir?
Now, the viper bite, sir, and admission to the hospital is in hours or in like a little bit of days or something like that?
Hours, sir, actually. In this patient, he presented to our hospital after 4 hours of viper bite, sir.
4 hours, because initial parameters like creatinine, everything was normal. Yes, sir. And then he started deteriorating very faster. Okay. Now, you have given sufficient anti-snake venom, and then we don't have monocomponent snake venom. That is the one big problem. Otherwise, we really don't know whether the capillary leak is because of the vein or because of this anti-snake venom. It is a big question mark to all of us. Because any related that the anti-snake venom leading to capillary leak syndromes?
Sir, actually, viper bite contains proteins like metal.
Yeah, that part is okay. Even if you use excess of anti-snake venom, and then does it can cause a little later some amount of like edema which persists, and we have to vasectomies have to be done. So many things we do, all the things. That is the reason. Have you worked on anything?
Sir, in this patient, we are thinking because of late presentation to the hospital, and his hemodynamic stability is not there, sir. Because of his hemodynamic instability, we did not get done plasmapheresis.
Yeah, plasmapheresis also will not be able to help him because he has deteriorated this thing, and you try to do again, the BP will fall and a lot of things will go into problems. Okay.
I just want to raise one point, sir, with your permission.
Please.
Actually speaking, in viper bites, they don't consider conjunction coagulopathy. So there is no role of anticoagulants. However, because of the cytokine storm and the capillary leak, can high doses of steroid help?
Yes, sir, there is a study showing that pulse therapy with steroids has helped in capillary leak syndrome, improvement in capillary leak syndrome, sir.
So was it tried in this case, sir?
We have given, sir, methylprednisolone pulse therapy we have given, sir.
And there was no improvement because of that at all?
No, sir.
Then as Dr. Kotiwala is asking the question, is there any adverse effect of multiple doses of anti-snake venom?
Sir,
because initially the creatinine was absolutely normal, and then it continued to deteriorate further.
Yes, sir.
Though I fully agree that it is an accepted therapy, but are there any yardsticks? How many vials to be given? I'm not updated. That is the reason I'm asking this question.
Sir, actually,
I was a part of a snake study, but that was only with the conjunction coagulopathies, because we used to get a lot of cases of cobra bite from southern area of Delhi near Qutub Minar. And Colonel R.N. Banerjee at that time, a great hematologist, he had used conjunction coagulopathy, and in spite of bleeding, he said, let's give low doses of heparin. That's what tried, and it is accepted. But about the viper bite, I have no idea. That's the reason I am asking you question. That is there any guideline about how much?
Guidelines are recommending, like we have to give 10 vials of ASV stats, sir, followed by 6 vials 6th hourly till the clotting time normalizes. Yeah. That is the recommendation.
Usually we try to give around 20 maximum or 24, but you are given 34. That is the reason I asked that in 24 hours time, you are given 34 vials, you mentioned.
As per recommendation, they told that 10 vials stat, yeah. And every sixth hourly, 6 vials we can give until the clotting time normalizes.
Yeah.
Maximum 4 doses.
Definitely, the condition itself may be bad, but you have used the steroid, then you have used anti-snake venom, then you are trying to control the inotropic support, probably with noradrenaline and other things. In spite of that, sometimes the montelukast and even terbutaline, all these things really help in some of these leaks can be prevented. Exact mechanism is not known. Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Ravi Teja. And any other questions are there, you can put on the chat box. Now, finally, I invite Anand Ambli, and who is emerging as one of the important faculty in the geriatric profession. and he has a passion, and with that the BLD has been now recognized well as far as the geriatric department is concerned, and he is going to talk on geriatric practice. Anand, yeah, approach to the emergencies in geriatrics.
Respected Chairperson, sir, Dr. Kotewale, sir, respected Vice President, Dr. Rajesh Onodigi, sir, Narayan Swami, sir, Secretary, all the respected dignitaries of the Association of Physicians of India, Karnataka chapter, and invited faculties and my mentor, Dr. Sharma, sir, and my dear students, a very good evening to all. At the outset, I thank Association of Physicians of India, Karnataka chapter for giving me this privileged opportunity to share my views on how to approach an older person in emergency department. And as our Vice President rightly mentioned, that we have this privilege because of the virtual classes, and we take this as a privilege from B.M. Patel Medical College as well. I bring greetings to you from the geriatric clinic of BLD Deemed University, Sri B.M. Patel Medical College Hospital and Research Center, Vijaypura. Now what happens is, all over the world, the studies regarding the admissions of older people in emergency department have shown that 57% of the patients belongs to the surgical conditions, while 43% belongs to the medical conditions. What is interesting to notice is, among the 57% of surgical conditions, the mortality rate is 17 to 18%, while medical admissions are less, the mortality rate is around 23 to 24%. The patients admitted with medical conditions have higher mortality than those of surgical conditions. This discussion is meant to help our residents to get the insight in providing care for the older people in emergency department. I hope all of you, all the senior members agree that our emergency units are getting aged, or are getting aging, because most of the cases in emergency units are older people above 60 years. And the discussion also should help the experience in the emergency department, especially for residents, the clinician, the older people, and the caregivers should be less stressful. And most importantly, the attitude of care should not replace the technology of care. Instead, we can take the help of the technology, but it should not replace our attitude and the care that we provide to the older people. This is an old lady who has come to our institute in an emergency department, and just looking at her, look at the what all she was put on, which is a navi, the blood pressure cuff, the ECG cables, the rope she was tied, the SpO2 monitor that she had, a Ryle's tube, or there's a Foley's catheter. So in an emergency setup, when an old lady, we require to use the technology and the assistance that is required to save their life. But what is more to be seen from a clinician, especially a geriatrician, what we see in her eyes, this lady had tears because she was in pain. And that is the only thing that conveyed to us through her eyes, was the tears in her eyes. A patient was referred to our hospital who was a 78-year-old. He was brought to the ED department in another hospital at around 10 a.m. And he had an acute exacerbation of chronic obstructive pulmonary disease with history of fall. He was seen by a medicine resident in another hospital. He had advised ECG and a chest X-ray, and the patient was shifted to a radiology unit. Then again, a reference was sought from an orthopedic surgeon. So he advised X-ray for pelvis, AP view. Again, the patient was lifted. He was shifted to a radiology, again brought back to the casualty in their hospital. Again, because he had a head injury, a neurosurgeon was called in. Again, when he came, he advised CT scan of the head. And this is what happened for the older patient in most of the hospitals, where they are brought to shifted to a radiology unit, to come back to the casualty, again shifted to radiology. So till 3 p.m., the patient was on the transfer mode in that hospital, and because they were not happy, so they came to our institute. So this is how the older people face hardship in an emergency department. So this discussion, I like to take the principles what our residents can follow to give a better care for the older people. As we all are aware, the older people, that 60 years and above, constitute highest admission rates in an emergency department. And assessing the older people in emergency department should be an opportunity for all of us to find what has been missing so far in many of the institutes where they were earlier admitted or for repeated admissions. Repeated admissions need to be addressed or assessed for elder abuse, self-neglect, and depression. Most of the authors in the literature have defined repeated admissions as more than 4 to 6 admissions in a year for the same symptoms. We also come across the older people who reach us in the terminal stage of the disease, where we should, as a consultant or a physician, should think of allowing natural death or respect the terminal wishes of the patient. Most of the times, the past history, the previous records of the health may not be available every time the patient comes to the emergency department. So we need to have a good assessment at our hands. And the geriatric emergency care model training is lacking all over the world. As we all aware, the case record folders, best measured in kilograms rather than pages, commonly testify the numerous departments previously involved in the care of majority of older patients. And we see that most of the older patients, they carry a bag, 2 bags of files that they have been referred earlier and seen by clinicians earlier. Now, coming to the principles of the older patients assessment in elderly department, emergency department, is we know about triage, clinical assessment, and the discharge. So my discussion will concentrate on clinical assessment. So the clinician or the resident who is taking care of the older persons in emergency department should be able to have a shared decision making among his colleagues of different departments as well. We should focus on the risk and the benefits of therapy. Always, we should consider the quality of life for the older people that we are going to give within the hospital and after the discharge. Interdisciplinary care should be priority. And the two main important thing a clinician must do is to avoid an iatrogenic harm. We should not use a polypharmacy, and we can even avoid the drugs which would not help him. And the most important thing is we need to avoid another disability as far as his disease are concerned. So for all these things, the time and resource management is very, very important, because one patient admitted in emergency department, it takes minimum 45 minutes to 1 hour for the things to settle, and then it has to be shifted to the intensive care unit as required. The pattern of disease that occurs in the older people, most of the common diseases that they come across emergency departments are acute onset, maybe infections, exacerbations or relapses of the existing diseases, either glycemia or hypertension, electrolyte disturbances, vascular disturbances like ischemic heart disease, stroke, intracerebral bleed, neurological disturbances already having degenerative diseases like Parkinsonism or Alzheimer's, and they develop complications, and of course musculoskeletal diseases. Along with this, an acute onset presentation, they will have multiple comorbidities. So this is a challenge. The residents in medicine who are going to face the older people in emergency department have to face these challenges along with an acute onset diseases. So all these comorbidities overlap and present challenges for a treating clinician. So the resident should be able to do a multidisciplinary and a multidimensional assessment in a short time. So that comes by experience. He should be able to identify atypical symptoms, that is very, very common in the older people. Silent symptoms, most of the times myocardial infarctions are silent in diabetes, and they present just to the breathlessness as a complication of a myocardial infarction. Disabilities has to be identified so that we will prevent another disability. Cognitive impairment has to be monitored. We have to assess the functional impairment that he had because of the disease process. Most importantly, we have to concentrate on the medications that the older person has been taking off record and on the records, and history of trauma and falls has to be assessed. Simultaneously, we should be capable to initiate a palliative care, allow natural death, and start conversation regarding end of life care. All these things should be analyzed and we should be capable to initiate in a given patient depends upon the condition it demands. So how do we approach an older person in emergency department? We take the history from the patient or the family members or the caregivers. Most of the times, we have to address issues like anxiety, fear, and depressions. Most of the older people, the moment they come to the emergency department, they just pray and beg us that please don't admit immediately. First, let me give me some time. They take more time to give a permission for their admissions. And the past history is longer than the present history. The caregiver and family members may or may not accompany. Sometimes, most of the times, it is the neighbor that come in the midnight. We need to contact the family physician who was treating him earlier so that we'll come to know the important points that he had in the health-wise. If there is a previous discharge summary, we must go through it. And of course, we should involve the patient and the family members in decision-making in whatever mode of modality of treatment you like to give for the patient. Again, the older persons who are staying alone, we don't get the proper history. And we don't know whether he had a medication compliance in the home. This is all put under question. Most of the times we saw that neighbors accompany the older man and he may not give consent for investigations till the relatives arrive. And even the family members are there. The history of fall in the bedroom or the bathroom is not reported. Either it is not seen or it is purposely concealed by the caregivers. If the patient had a seizure, most of the time patient attendants not have seen or we not reported by the family members. And abuse, the patients who are neglected, the history is avoided by the caregivers. So once the patient comes in the emergency department, what we should look for? We should look for vital signs, we all know. The two more important vital signs added to the pulse, respiratory rate, temperature and respiratory rate is blood pressure is pain and the delirium. So these two are the added vital signs to be assessed in the older persons. Of course, nowadays we are checking the saturation, look for the anemia, jaundice and dehydration. This is very important. Dehydration has to be assessed. Involuntary movements, pupils, plantar and signs of injury. This should be a quick assessment, should hardly take a few minutes. And of course, respiratory system examination, cardiovascular, per abdomen, muscular system examination should be carried simultaneously for this. And meantime, depending upon the condition of the patient, if he is in respiratory distress or is in coma, you can start oxygen, get an GRBS done, and if it is hypoglycemia, immediately correct it, or hyperglycemia, immediately start the treatment. ECG should be taken immediately at the bedside and find that if there is any cardiac or vascular event. Bedside X-ray should be done immediately because we don't know whether the community acquired pneumonia patients can come with delirium. Injury part also should be assessed by the X-ray. And simultaneously, we should send the blood for biochemical and pathological test. And immediately, we should secure an IV line whenever the person is brought to an emergency department. We should also ask the patient attenders or the caregivers about the acuity of daily living, instrumental acuity of daily living before 1 week or before a day of admission to the emergency department. What are the challenges a resident can come across when he deals with an older person in an emergency department? So the older man can have a decreased hearing, reduced vision, he may be in delirious state, he may be depressed, he may have dementia, dehydrated, frailty is again important, sarcopenia, and the reduced functional capacity. All these poses challenges for a treating clinician in assessing the older person in an emergency department. We should all be aware regarding the geriatric giants. The five geriatric giants that like immobility, falls, incontinence, pressure sores, and confusion can all be a presenting features of the hidden disease. The fall may be a manufacturing feature of a myocardial infarction. In confusion or delirium can be a presenting feature of pneumonia. These five geriatric giants were described by Isaacs in 1992, while the recent new generation geriatricians have now put the another giant like iatrogenic disorders where we as a clinician add because of the drugs that we can create another giant in them, polypharmacy. So I'll just share what are the do's and don'ts, what the clinician can practice in an emergency department. When we come across an older person in an emergency department, we should orient the person to that place, time, and who are all we taking care of him. Ensure that we adequate hydration is maintained. A good communication is very, very important. Listen to him and your gestures that you are understanding what he's talking. Involve the team members. This is very, very important. Involving the residents, postgrad students, even the interns, nurses, social servants, all social people and the servants, all should be involved in taking care of the older people. And please plan to do all the investigations required in the same go. Plan it, let it be a little half an hour late, but you should, once it is shifted to radiology unit, all the investigations required should be done in one go or preferably in a bedside status. And of course, we should involve the caregivers and patient in decision-making process. And the don'ts, please avoid tying the older persons to the bed, and even that begets the delirium again, putting the multiple tubes, unless it is required, of course, and should not restrict the patient meeting the family members. This is very important because allow the patient, older persons to meet their family members so that they can have a good rapport and they feel comfort, they feel secured in the hospital. Of late, there's a concept of geriatric friendly emergency departments in many countries. It is coming. We can even do in our own setup depending upon the requirement and the facilities that are available in our own institute. So what we should do in an emergency department to make the older feel safe is that we can keep him warm. If he wants to have some coffee or tea, we can provide it at the emergency or make comfortable. And if he wants to move around using the walker, he can be made, and he should not be left alone on the bed for the long time. And if we overlook these important needs, we can lead to the increased risk of delirium in an older person. Providing reclining chairs, this is very, very comfortable for the older people. Warming blankets, privacy is very important. The older person, they feel that they're undignified when the privacy is not given to them. And in case if they are short of hearing, you can use voice amplification devices also. And the older person in emergency department, till you do a complete assessment and want to transfer to the intensive care unit, he should have an easy access to restrooms, available availability of mobility aids and walkers for him to use the restrooms. So what has been found that the older people are being tied to the bed for just to prevent a fall in the hospital and making them immobile, which further aggravates the existing diseases. And it has also been found that in our part of North Karnataka, we see that the older people, they first go to the faith healers where they have been treated with their banding marks and their hot iron rods are posted, and these people, they turn up with septicemia. And earlier there were round dots all over the body or the along the nerve endings, but now they also have the faith healers have become new generation, like they are putting the scar marks that is seen on the right side of the photographs. We should be also aware that our emergency departments or intensive care units produce more noise and create noise pollution rather than the regular setup what we have. So we should avoid the monitors beeping around the clock even in the emergency department. And this is a lady who presented 80 years old female, history of fall, and the impact of the fall was so much that she had almost a hemorrhage on the upper eyelid, and she was still walking around, and on doing a CT scan we found that there was a huge infarct in the temporal occipital area. So any patient, what we want to convey is if they come with the fall and such an impact of injury is there, we should not miss a diagnosis, and we should evaluate thoroughly before we send them home. And of course, again, as I mentioned you, we come across all types of patients in our emergency department. So this is a case of malignant growth, which has multiple ulcerative fungating growths, and whatever she used to drink used to come through that opening, and there were a lot of maggots. Hardly any attenders were able to be with her, and this is where we should initiate a palliative care. So emergency department is where we can think of variety of modalities of care that can be provided to the older persons. So with this discussion, I like to conclude that the complete process of evaluation and examination does not happen in one setup in emergency department. It takes a long time.
Most of the time, the older person whom you go to meet and he just holds your hand, he doesn't leave it. He holds it for a long time and you have to just try to remove your hand. That happens with persons with dementia and those who are in failures. The process of evaluation of an older person in emergency department rewards speed. The time frame is immediate. We should be quick in assessing. Simultaneously, we should be quick in starting the immediate treatment. And focus is on the patient's complaint. And I like to emphasize that one size fits all will not be possible for all the patients, elderly patients coming to emergency department. That's why there has been no guideline from any of the authorities all over the world that how the emergency department we should handle the older persons. It is depends upon their setup, the manpower that they are having and the type of emergency they are getting. And I request all the practitioners and the residents to say no to ageism. Don't discriminate the older people for treatment in emergency wards. And as it, the saying goes in the English, it's one has a hammer, one tends to look for nails. So unless because we have a lot of technological gadgets and assessments, tools, so we try to use them, but we have to think when what benefits, always the benefits to the older person. We should always look at the preventing the or giving the good quality of life and of course a dignified death to the older person. And for all these things to happen, in a short time in an emergency department, we need to have a team and team works. So just to conclude, I quote Williamson, almost everything to do with the health of the elderly is a matter of urgency. If an older person is unwell on Monday, the chances are that he or she will be worse on Tuesday. And by the end of the week, may be bedridden, dehydrated, confused, and incontinent, I unquote. So this statement, though quoted in 1978, still holds true that we should never deny or delay the management process in an older person when he visits the emergency departments. Thank you very much for this opportunity, privileged opportunity, and thank you for all your patience listening.
Thank you, Anand Ambli. It was comprehensively you have given approach to the geriatric population. Though they look old, really they are not that old, but electrolytes, infections, and ICU psychosis is what commonly we come across in people who have no diseases. But diseases also do come because of vascular disease, degenerative diseases, and then malignancies are commonly coming. But even if they don't have anything, infections, electrolyte imbalances, and then some psychosis related to here and there will be seen frequently. We have the renowned godfather and mentor for geriatrics, Dr. O.P. Sharma, will conclude his remarks on this so that we'll take care of all this.
Sir, at the outset, I would like to say that API Karnataka chapter is doing a wonderful job. I would also like to compliment Karnataka for one thing about which I couldn't make a remark earlier. That was about the vaccination. The first vaccine in the country was used in Karnataka only for Maharaja's family. The first Indian guidelines which have been made for older persons in the year 2008, the mentor have been Karnataka. I cannot forget Professor P.S. Shankar's contribution in the same. And both Vijayapura as well as Belgavi have got geriatric clinics, geriatric departments, that is again commendable. Professor Ambali, it's always a pleasure to listen to you. And can conclude from your talk is that to become a good geriatrician, one should be a good human being, a good clinician who depends on the clinical judgment. And what I teach during my ward rounds is that in the patient, try to see the image of your grandfather or grandmother and your whole attitude will change. I think a clinical judgment is the key. Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. since a lot of other people, because of I saw that Anitaj Basavaraj and other men, many have joined from Maharashtra and other thing, and it is a very nice that all have logged in, and since there are some chat boxes questions are there, then if they are able to, I am asking this who is monitoring that.
We are monitoring, sir. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. If any one or two important questions, because we are already.
No, sir. We don't have any questions.
Yeah, yeah. We don't. Yeah, yeah. Since there are no other questions, then yes. We to save the time and all the things. That I am seeing that Dr. Chandrasekhar sir, who is a mentor for all of us, and because of him, our API has gone in such a discipline, and I have to quote this since many people have joined here. Namaskar, Chandrasekhar sir. Yeah, since there are no other questions and anything, I request our secretary to give the vote of thanks.
On behalf of API Karnataka chapter, I immensely thank our chairman, Dr. V. A. Kotiwale, for conducting today's virtual monthly clinical meeting. On behalf of API Karnataka chapter, I also thank BLD Deemed University, Sri B.M. Patil Medical College, Research Center and Hospital, Vijayapura, for hosting today's monthly clinical virtual meeting. I thank immensely the Medicine Department of Sri B.M. Patil Medical College Research Institute for hosting the today's meeting. HOD, Professor and HOD, Dr. Sharon Badige, Dr. Rajesh Vannuttigi, Professor of Medicine, and Dr. Anand Ambali, Professor of Geriatrics, I thank Professor Sharma sir for today's interactive virtual monthly clinical meeting. I thank all the presenters who presented all the cases, interesting cases, in the virtual monthly clinical meeting. I thank all the senior professors. I thank all the faculty of BLD Deemed University. I thank all the honorable APA members. I thank one and all for today's virtual monthly clinical meeting. Thank you all. Next month, the virtual monthly clinical meeting will be hosted by Medicine Department, KIMS Hubballi, and details will be mailed later. Thank you one and all.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It was a pleasure to join it. It was a great learning session. Thank you, Karnataka API. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
My namaskar to Dr. Kotiwala, sir.
Namaste, ji. Namaskar, sir. We will definitely invite you for all the meetings. And it is our privilege, and I really sincerely thank all the members who have joined from Maharashtra, Delhi, and other places. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
And my respect to Professor Chandrasekhar, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
क्या एक्टिंग कर रहा
है?
उससे
गवारा है
खुद एक्टिंग कर रहा है सुभाष
देव. Hello. Sir, Narayan Swami sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Dr.
Rajesh. Sir, thank you for giving us opportunity. And I also congratulate our postgraduate students and Dr. Anand Ambali for their excellent presentation. Again, once again, thank all the distinguished members who were present for this session and for their patient hearing. Thank you, one and all, sir.
Thank you, sir.